Welcome to week two of the SEM 1 course. And in this week, I'll talk about fitting confirmatory factor analysis model. So how to use software, I have a video on that. How to interpret measures of fit and how to judge fit and how to compare models. And I have a series of videos on this. And the first one is this one, which is about the general fitting of a CFA model. So this is what CFA models look like, as we saw last week. This path diagram is actually drawn with a software called SEMplot that I made quite some time ago. I have some examples on SEMplot on this GitHub page, as well as examples on how to fit SEM models, how to fit CFA models. The CFA is a special case of SEM, right? So you can look at that. And if you have any ideas about SEMplot, it's not really something I'm actively developing anymore. But if you want to contribute to that, or you want to make change to that, that's also let me know, and then maybe we can find something that you can work on and pick up. So this is the Lavaan package that I talk a bit more about in some of the videos. And that's one of the main packages that you can use. Some other ones are Psychonetics, which I made myself. Onyx, which is a graphical interface, Jazz, which is a really nice SPSS-like program that has a Lavaan backend or frontend, OpenMX, UMX, M+, and there are many more SEM packages you can use. And then, if you for many of these, they're supported in SEMplot, so you can just draw SEM a path diagram using a code like this, for example. Okay, so last week I talked about this maximum likelihood fitting function, this FML here. And I also made a separate video explaining more where this expression comes from. So this is the likelihood ratio, or the log likelihood ratio. This is one way in which you can optimize a SEM model. It's a common way that some packages use, some other packages use something else. So in Psychonetics, as I explained in the more detailed video, I use another function, which is not a likelihood ratio, but really just a likelihood. And Lavaan actually reports something called fmin, which is this, but then divided by 2. And you'll see all kinds of variants on that. So it's good to know if you really want to delve into software what they actually do. But in the end, they all basically boil down to this expression here, and especially to this expression here. This t equals n times fml. Right? Or in the case of fmin, you have to multiply by 2 still. So this t is always reported. And this is probably the most important statistic that we find in structural equation modeling, that you always see reported in papers as well. And it's the first thing that the software will report when you ask for it to print some information. So what is this t? This t is a summary statistic. And it's a summary statistic of the fit. So as we saw, or as I discussed in the previous lecture, FML will be 0 if S perfectly resembles sigma. So we have a perfect model where our implied structure is exactly equal to the observed covariance structure. That will be an ideal world. But your data comes from a sample, so you're not in an ideal world. And by definition, this will not be true, and this will not be true, except when degrees of freedom equals 0, because then we can perfectly reproduce S. Otherwise, it will be somewhere close to S if you have good fit, and not close to S if you have bad fit. So let's say if there's a correlation in S that is like 0.9 and sigma implies there's a correlation of 0, then it will be a bad fit. So FML will be somewhere near 0 if it's good and far above 0 if it's a bad fit. So how do we define near 0 and far above 0? Well, that we do with this t-statistic, which is often also simply called the chi-square statistic. So many software packages, including Psychonetics and Lavaan, will not say t, they will say chi-square. But in the slide, I make a difference between them because it's a bit more clear. Okay, so what is this? Well, the nice thing about this t-statistic is that it has this property that if sigma is actually the true variance coverage matrix of the data, sorry, of the model, it's not the data because the data has a observed variance coverage matrix. But if in the true world, in the true model, sigma is the true variance coverage matrix, and we would generate data from that and then fit our model and get our observed variance coverage matrix. Then this T distribution would be chi-square distributed with the same number of degrees of freedom as in the model. So that's this expression here, which is very important. So this says that if sigma is actually the true model, then this test statistics will have a chi-square distribution, which means it will not exactly be zero, but the chi-square distribution actually looks a bit like this. So this is a 0 point. Oh. This is a 0 point, and it will have a bit of a shape like this. So T is near zero most of the time, but it can actually be quite far from zero as well with some probability. And this is nice, because this means that we can use this T statistics for hypothesis testing. We can test the hypothesis that this is the true variance coverage structure. All right, so let's first look a bit into R to show you that indeed this fmin and this fml is exactly what you get from the software. So this is just some Lavaan code that gives you the fmin that's reported by Lavaan from the optimizer. And 2 times this equals exactly what we get from filling in this equation on the last slide manually, which is the same value here. So that's the fmin of the fml. And then to show that this is indeed equal to this chi-square distribution, we simply multiply this with n. Then we get this 85.3 here. And then if you look in Lavaan and we ask for the chi-square test, it's the exact same value. So this is where it comes from. It's not magic. It's you can actually just obtain this yourself as well if you want. Okay, so with this test statistic, we can test the hypothesis that the variance of y equals sigma. In fact, we can try to reject this hypothesis. So it's a bit of an inverse way of thinking than you normally do with significance testing. Here, our H0 is that the variance of y equals sigma. And we can try to reject that and with the alternative hypothesis that the variance of y is not equal to sigma. Okay, so what do we want to do here? Well, actually, we don't want to reject our hypothesis. So it's a bit of an inverse way of thinking than you normally do with a t-test, for example, where your hypothesis is the null test, where an effect is zero. Now we're not testing if the effect is zero, we're actually testing if the effect is what we found. So it's a different way of thinking. And this is in line, actually, with, so I had some discussion about this yesterday as well in the practical. This is in line with the way that you think about falsifying models, right? So falsification. So what we do is we have a theory, have an idea that sigma is a true model, and then we try to falsify this. Right? So that's perfectly in line with Popperian thinking. And then if we cannot falsify it, that's good, because we could have falsified our hypothesis, and we tried to falsify it, but we couldn't. That does not mean that we actually have evidence that this is true. Because that's, of course, the thing that you always have in frequentist statistics. We cannot actually gain evidence for this hypothesis. We can merely say we tried to falsify it and we couldn't. So, of course, if we have only 2 observations, we're probably not going to get a significant p-value here. But if you have 1 million observations or 1,000, then if you don't get a significant p-value, that's actually quite a substantial thing to say, because we really tried to falsify it with a lot of power and we couldn't. But we shouldn't immediately translate it to evidence for the null. So that's an important distinction that you need to make. But ideally, then it means that we want to have our p-value above alpha. And usually we set that to 0.05. And then in this case, it would be a good thing. Now, as I'll discuss later, this chi-square test is actually, the danger is usually not in that it's underpowered, except if you have really few cases. The danger is more that it's overpowered and it will eject very fast, so you usually get a significant p-value. And that's why I'll talk about fitnesses later. Okay, so this is the chi-square distribution. This is zero, to indicate perfect fit. And actually the amount of mass as zero is actually zero, because you cannot get perfect fit if you have a real number of values. You cannot always get zeros. It would be like 0.00001 or something like that. So we have this shape here. The center point of the shape is the degrees of freedom. So that means that if you see chi square is lower than degrees of freedom, you already know that your p-value is not significant. So you don't need to do any testing, because then you're somewhere in this range here, which is a good thing for you. And then we can see where is our test statistic. So our test statistic is here, for example. We got a chi square of 50 in this case. Right, so this is an hypothetical example, it's not the example I showed before. Then we can look at the area that's more extreme than the test value. Right, so that's what we do. We try to test this test value or more extreme values. And then we see that this has a probability of 0.01, so that's our p-value, which is lower than 0.05. So then we can say that the model does not fit the data or reject this hypothesis. Right, and there's some area here, which is our critical boundary area. Now here I have another hypothetical example, where I have a test statistic of 30. And now the test statistic is here, so we have a larger range or larger probability mass. We get a p-value of 0.185, and that is above 0.05, so that's a good thing in this case. So then we would say we would not reject the hypothesis, and then we can actually say that the model fits. And what we can actually say then is that we tried to reject the hypothesis for exact fit, and we couldn't, so that's a good thing. Okay, so let's look at Levan, and well, we have our Levan model. This is the Holzinger-Swinegold data, so it's a three-factor model with three indicators each, designed to measure three abilities in schools, like visual, textual, and speed in like abilities in children. And actually I have a video up online now as well, where I show this data set in like five different software packages, and you get constantly the same chi-square test and the same degrees of freedom. And what we see here is that p is 0.0000. It's somewhere like above zero, of course, but very, very low. So we could say that the model does not fit. So we're sad, because the model doesn't fit. Okay. So is that the end of the world? Well, no, it's not. Because your model is probably wrong. Actually, I can already guarantee you that your model is wrong, because even the all these symbols are actually like quite simple, right? So let's go back to this model here, which is the model that we're talking about, with visual, textual, and speed. This is an extremely simple model. It's very likely that there's all kinds of stuff happening under the hood as well. That's not in line with this model. So all models are wrong, but some are maybe useful. So we can already know exactly that your model is probably wrong, and the exact fit will probably be rejected. But then we could still see if the model is a good description of the data, to see if it's close to being right, and if it's still like a good description. If it still predicts data pretty well, like sigma is still very closely related to S and explains a lot of S, then that's still a very useful model that we can use, and then we could still say it's a good model. So the true model might not be exactly the same, but it might be nearly the same. So we can think of like, okay, maybe there's like a very small effects here, maybe there's other things, maybe there are nonlinear effects. The reality is probably much, much more complicated than this very simple model, where we have three factor loadings and one normally distributed latent variable per item. Right, it's also the argument that we make in the network literature as well. Probably the real world is more complicated than this. We probably also don't have local independence, so we can expect that there's all kinds of stuff happening here. Maybe more stuff than we can actually fit. Right, so you should expect that chi square will be significant. So as n goes to infinity, we should expect to reject the hypothesis here and to get a significant chi square. And infinity actually here is not that high. You should already expect this to be like 1,000 or maybe sometimes even 100. Like it happens quite fast, you'll get a significant effect here. Okay, so that's the test of exact fit. Now in the next video lecture, I'll talk about fit measures, where we can get indices to show if our model is still good. So if it's still a good model, it might not be exactly right, but if it's still close. So then we're going to test for close fit. But with the test for exact fit, it's still a very important measure, because still all other fit measures are also based on this t value here, this test statistic. So that's why it always has to be reported, and you always see it as first thing reported by the software. But it's not ideal in many cases. There are also some problems with it. So if you have small sample sizes, then there's actually quite some work showing weird things. So actually the chi-square distribution is only valid asymptotically, so when n is infinite, and that's not the case when you have like 30 or so. So the approximation is quite poor, so that can lead to over-rejection, but you also have an underpowered, cases, so then you can have under-rejection. So that is a weird thing. So in general, basically, with small sample size, the chi-square test is not that great. And with large chi-square ends, large sample sizes, we can actually expect to be rejecting the hypothesis a lot, because the test then has a lot of power and it's probably just not true to exact fit. So in general, even though we have to report it all the time, usually we just expect to get a significant test here, effect here, and that we won't really get much meaningful inference out of it. And that's why we also look at measures for close fit. Okay, so that's it for this video on exact fit, and the next video I'll talk about measures for close fit.